kind of a light is this? It's a neon light. We talk about neon lights, and you know, you go to Vegas and there's all these neon lights. It's these orange ones that truly are neon lights. They're glass tubes that have neon gas in them. Now, the blue one is not technically a neon light, but we kind of just use that term for all of them. So the neon gas in this tube absorbs electrical energy, and then it releases that electrical energy as light. And it does so as light with particular wavelengths. So neon always gives orange light when you excite it with electricity. Other gases will do this as well. This is a mercury lamp. So if you take mercury vapor and pass electric current through it, it will glow blue. Always. And hydrogen glows pink. And you can make different lamps out of different elements, and they have different colors.
Can you combine them?
You could combine them, yes.
And will they make a unique color? Or will they,
they would make a combination of the colors. So like if you put these two together, pink and blue, you'd get sort of a violet color. Well, depending on what gases you put together, they might react. Yeah, you got gases in there and you shoot electricity through there. You're kind of asking for a reaction. But like if you mix different noble gases together, they're not going to react because they don't react with much of anything. Yes?
Other than pressing in, for what color it was produced, is there any way of telling for it? Or you just have
is there any way to predict what color?
Yes.
Not really, no. No. There's not really a way to predict what color a given element would release. They've tried them all, though, so we can look them up, yeah. So we just saw a picture of the hydrogen lamp. Here it is again. Makes this pink color. Well, we had a picture like this before where we took sunlight or light from an incandescent light bulb and ran it through a prism, and we got a beautiful rainbow here. When we take light from the hydrogen lamp and put it through the same instrument, instead of a rainbow, we get four lines of color. And it happens the same way all the time. There's a sort of a reddish orange, and there's like a cyan blue, and there's like an indigo and a violet. Always the same. And these different colors correspond to individual wavelengths of light. Now, when scientists noticed this, they were surprised. And this was a big clue as to what was going on inside the atom. So a continuous spectrum will look like this. That's what you get from sunlight or from something that you heat until it's just so hot it's glowing. Hydrogen light gives us this spectrum. Helium gives this spectrum, a little more complicated. And neon gives us this spectrum. So that bright orange color that we see is the combination of all of those, but these this red and yellow and orange predominates, and so we see that distinct orange color. So every element is going to have its own individual light spectrum, and in a way that acts as a fingerprint. And so if you see these particular lines, you know that hydrogen is in there. So these are discrete spectra, and this is a continuous spectra. So how could this happen? Why does hydrogen only give off light of particular wavelengths? Well, a guy named Niels Bohr, and we had a quote from him back when at the beginning about, I forget which one he said. You can go back and look at it. He came up with a very simple model to explain this. And so this is called the Bohr model of the atom. I'll tell you right now, it's not correct. So then why am I even bothering you to tell you about it? Because it's relatively easy to understand. And understanding this helps us to start getting our mind around the real explanation. So this is the Bohr model of the atom. Here we have the nucleus. That's where the protons and the neutrons are, squished crazy tight together. And then the electrons are in these different orbits. Okay, this is a lot like the solar system, right? Where you have the sun in the middle and the planets orbit around the sun and they have their different orbits, right? So what happens here is you have an electron in this first level, n equals 1. As you go out, these orbits have higher energy. So for hydrogen, it only has one electron, so it's going to have one electron in the n equals 1 level. It's going to be in the lowest level. If you put it in a hydrogen lamp and turn the electricity on and zap it, it can absorb that energy. Come on, iPad. Play nice. So say we've got the electron there, and you zap it. Well, it may absorb enough energy to jump up to n equals 4. It's not going to stay up there, though, because that's not very stable. Everything in nature tends towards lower energy. That's why stuff falls down instead of up. So it can get jumped up there by this jolt of electricity, but then it's going to fall back down. If it absorbed energy when it went up, it has to release energy when it comes down. That energy gets released as a photon of light. And that photon of light has a particular wavelength corresponding to the energy of that transition. So we see the distance from the nucleus and the energy of each of those orbits is fixed, or we say it's quantized. So a little bit like a ladder. If this is a funky looking ladder, huh? If you're climbing up this ladder, you can stand on the first rung or the second rung. You can't stand in between, can you? There's nothing to stand on. It's like climbing stairs. You can be on the first step or the second step or the third step. You can't stand in between the steps. Or on a ramp, you could be any distance. So if you had a ramp here, you could be anywhere along this ramp. And, you know, let's just say this was 2 feet high. 2 feet. Well, you could stand halfway up and be 1 foot high, or you could go back down a little bit and 3/4 of a foot. I mean, you could be anywhere, right? Because it's continuous. On the ladder, you can only be certain levels, certain amounts above the ground. Okay, so this, from this lowest rung, and maybe it's 2 feet here, and 1.5 feet up to there, and 1 foot there, and 1/2 foot, and 1/4 of a foot. You can't be anywhere in between. It's a little bit like grades in school. You can be in first grade, or you can be in second grade. You can't be in 1.33 grade. There isn't one. No. No, you can't. And our monetary system is also quantized. Think about paper money. There's a $1 bill, the lesser known $2 bill. There's a $5 bill and a $10 and a $20. Have you ever seen a $15.75 bill? You could make one, but it's not legal tender, right? It's quantized. So these orbits are quantized. You can be in the n equals 1 orbit or in the n equals 2 orbit. You can't be in between. So what happens is that this electron absorbs energy, and that energy can come from different sources. Since we're talking about these gas emission tubes, we'll talk about it coming from electricity. That electron, this energy comes in, it absorbs the energy, and it jumps up to a higher energy level, a higher orbit. It doesn't stay there, though. It's going to relax down to a lower level. It doesn't have to relax down to the level it came from. It could relax down to any of the levels that are lower. So if it jumps from n equals 1 to n equals 3 and then relaxes from n equals 3 to n equals 2, the light that's given off, we can measure its energy by the wavelength of it, and that energy corresponds to the difference in the energy between those two orbits. And by measuring the frequency, I mean the wavelength of those those lines that hydrogen emits, they were able to calculate the energy of all these different orbits that the electron can be in hydrogen. And it was really, really cool. So a photon is also known as a quantum of light, a piece of light, a particular packet. So the red light that hydrogen gives off has a wavelength of 657 nanometers, and that corresponds to an electron moving from n equals 3 down to n equals 2. The blue-green light, 486 nanometers, that's from n equals 4 down to n equals 2. See, this is a bigger transition. This is a higher energy light. And this is even higher in energy. This is from n equals 5 down to n equals 2. Now, the reason that those are interesting to us is those are the ones we can see with our eyes. There are other transitions, and they give off energy as well, but we can't see them visually. So, Bohr model, very successful for hydrogen. Predicted the lines of the emission spectrum, and it was awesome. So then they tried to apply it to helium. Helium has 2 electrons. It doesn't work for helium, or lithium, or boron, or anything bigger than hydrogen. So from that standpoint, it's not all that useful, because it only works for hydrogen. It was replaced with a more sophisticated model called the quantum mechanical model.